Hello and welcome to Some Assembly Required. I realize it's been a while since my last video, but boy oh boy was I busy. As hinted by the closing remarks on my previous video, I've thrown away everything I've done so far and replaced it with a brand new implementation of the 6502, called CompuSAR 6502 for Some Assembly Required 6502. This new implementation is driven by a completely new design, but despite starting from scratch, I think I'm pretty far along. My implementation prioritizes opcodes that might tax my design. So as you can see, I've already implemented all of the standard branches. I've implemented the read, modify, write commands. I've implemented the LDA commands with all of their addressing modes. In fact, I've implemented most addressing modes already. So at this point, I can be fairly certain that this design will carry me through to the end. To be completely honest, the previous design also could carry me through to the end. However, it suffered from a few fundamental problems that were very difficult to fix without starting over, which is what I did. The old project's design had two main problems that caused me to abandon it. The first is the fact that some of the register latch on the falling edge of the clock and some on the rising edge of the clock. The other problem with this design is that some of the inputs are latched while others are not. So, a new design. What did I do here? First, everything is latched on the falling edge of the clock. I know people who design FPGAs find that weird, but that's a requirement of the timing diagram of the 6502. Also, for all practical reasons, all inputs are latched. In order to live up to the timing requirements, that requires that all outputs are pretty much asynchronous logic. But that's fine, because if we look at the timing diagram, we can see that our settle time is sometimes reasonable and sometimes downright long. Our input setup time, however, is not that long. So the timing diagram pretty much supports this design. Due to switching to only using one edge of the clock, we're now more constrained for our use of the cycles we have. Many FPGA implementations consider some of the cycles quote-unquote dead cycles. We actually use them, so maybe we're closer to the original 6502 implementation. Yeah, not really. I try to limit the decoder to as few control signals as possible. Control signals require logic to say not only when they're used, but also when they're not used, thus dramatically increasing the number of LUTs we need in order to implement the CPU. Of course, that comes at a cost. The original 6502 had a data bus, two address bus, the address bus low and the address bus high, and a bus called SP, which I don't know what it stands for. So four 8-bit buses altogether. The FPGA equivalent of a high impedance bus is a multiplexer, of which I have 11. Now you might be wondering whether I don't need control signals to control the multiplexers, and yeah, you're right, I would. And you might be wondering whether those signals don't need LUTs in order to control their state. And the answer is yes, they do. However, I have a plan, which I will not reveal yet. I will reveal it once I finish implementing all of the opcodes. Since I'm guessing no more architectural changes will be required, I think that should be fairly quickly now. I'm guessing 2 or 3 weeks, considering my day jobs and family requirements. Let's go over a few design highlights. First, there's the ALU. The ALU is composed completely of asynchronous logic. As a design decision, I have ALU cycles. This means that anytime I want to do something with the ALU, the data that goes into the input is already available at the beginning of the cycle, and the ALU result is only latched at the end of the cycle. So anything done with the ALU takes an entire cycle. On the one hand, this means that dead cycles aren't. The flip side is that I've removed one barrier to increasing the clock speed. If the ALU is needed, it has an entire cycle to work. For the most part, this architecture works well with being cycle accurate for the original 6502 and variants. However, there's one component that I had to do something special. The program counter is a register, which means it has state. However, it responds to some of its control signals immediately. So if we're telling it to load a new value from the address in, this value gets outputted immediately. Of course, it also goes right back into the register to be stored for the next cycle. Telling the program counter to advance to the next address, however, only takes effect in the following cycle. So that goes only into the flip-flop not to the output.
The re-architecture isn't the only change I've made. You have to remember that the previous project was the first major project I've ever written for FPGA, ever. So, obviously, there's a lot I've learned along the way. The main one I did, and it has huge impact on ease of development, is the use of enums instead of preprocessor macros for specifying the control signals and bus sources. In system Verilog, each enum is a distinct type, so you cannot assign an enum controlling one bus to another. This catches silly mistakes early, before they become hard to debug problems. A lot of FPGA experts showed displeasure at my use of this huge case for decoding the opcodes. Everyone seemed to be pushing for the use of the traditional ROM in order to encode the microcode that defines the opcodes. I chose to keep the big case and I do a future video about explaining the reasoning. Something else that drew a lot of criticism is the extensive use of tests in order to encapsulate parts of the design. Again, as a software developer, I stand by this decision. One thing that made a huge impact on development speed and ease is the subject of the previous video, the use of the test harness in order to generate the test program and the test plan. The ability to easily make changes to the test program and just run a command, let it run, and get the test plan all ready and verified is a huge benefit. The test program runtime on the test harness is already up to 21 seconds and it will probably increase further, but since it's not anything I need to do myself, then that's time well spent. The ability to hit run test and then almost immediately get a report saying whether my design is behaving like the real CPU is an amazing benefit that is hard to describe. The fact that the test plan contains cycle-by-cycle description of what goes on the bus means that I do not need to open an emulator or run the command manually. I just run the test will tell me whenever I deviate, and the combination of the nearby comment saying which opcode it was and the that bus address gives me everything I need in order to debug whatever it is that I did wrong. So there you have it. Adding a brand new operation takes me about 10 minutes. Of course, if it's just matching an existing operation to an existing addressing mode, it takes considerably less. In that case, writing the test program is the most time-consuming part of the process, and due to the recent changes, even that takes considerably less time. So I'm pretty optimistic about completing this fairly soon. Of course, I still need to decide what to do with the page I took out of the datasheet documenting all the progress I made on the old project. Somehow, it doesn't seem right just throwing it away. So that's all I have for you today. I promised you a video about optimizations and I will get to it once all the opcodes are implemented. In the meanwhile, EdBitGuy released video 8 in his History of Commodore series about the Amiga 1000, and it's a video I cannot not respond to. So that's probably what the next video will be about. Short version is, I love it, go watch it. Until then, thank you for watching.